I hate tutorial videos which don't get to the point. So let's get to the point. This video serves as an introduction to the syntax of Haskell. And if you really want to know everything about the syntax, then I cannot highly enough recommend just reading Haskell's language report. This contains everything you would want to know about the language. And this stuff is described very tersely. The language report is available freely, so you have no reason to not read it. Anyway, on to my version of it. In Haskell, really you don't even have operators, you have functions. In Haskell, let's take this. You have the operator plus. But really, that is this in disguise. This is a function. It might not look like one, but it is. It's a function which returns the sum of its arguments. Well, that's all cool. But why is that important? That means you can make your own operators pretty easily. See? Just did it there. And I redefined it. That's something unique to this interpreter. In a compiled file, we can't do that. Anyway, let's make a simpler function because I don't think using zipwidth in a beginning thing is fair. Actually, you know what? That might be a nice change. Anyway, we define here a function slash slash which takes arguments alpha and bravo. The purpose of this function is this applies zipwidth to alpha and bravo with the function divide. As you can see, the actual definition there is fairly straightforward. Just use the equal sign, give it your arguments, and you're good. You can also do what's called point free style, which you saw me do. These are equivalent, but point free is useful when you repeat yourself. You know, you get rid of a few characters and you sometimes even make it more readable. That's functions. Alright. What about variables? We can do that. We can do that. The problem with this, though, is here the compiler automatically decides which type you want. And I don't like that. And neither should you. So you should do this. You should tell it the type of the variable you want. And what this does is those two colons, they say that whatever's on the left should be given the type on the right. Or first argument should be given the type of its second argument. Well, I've never had to use it that way, so... Yeah, I was wrong. I'm learning something. Yeah, you can also do that. That's called a lambda expression. Yeah. If you want to make another function, you can do. See here, we define another function, print shit. This takes an argument kilo, and the way that dollar operator works is it just does this. Okay. That prints kilo as appended by the letter Yankee. This is another good thing to discuss. The first, lists. A list is just an ordered set. This contains multiple values, and these values are distinct from each other. In functional programming, learning to think about things in terms of lists is very important. Because functional programming, a cornerstone of that, are statements like map, and fold. Lists are good. I recommend just playing around with lists until you think you understand them. Or, better yet,
read the specification.
Didn't mean to put the whole thing on the screen there. Alright, on to this little plus-plus thing. In C, this would be 2. In Haskell, it's meaningless. Instead, what you do is... this just appends the second list to the first list. Well, it's a fairly simple function, but it's extremely useful. If you work with any type of text, you'll find yourself using that very, very often. It's also worth mentioning that strings here, this is a type string, which is aliased. Just a list of characters. That's what it really is. You know, it helps to think of it like that. Anyway, that's really what I was going to say, is it's important to remember that His or equivalent. It's called syntactic sugar. Just makes the stuff a bit more readable for humans. What else do we have? Yeah. Let's make an actual program. Every program needs a main directive. And in this case, this is print penis 69. And penis is a function which takes an integer and it outputs an integer. That's all that this type definition means. Now for all values kilo, penis kilo is equal to the sum of kilo and 1. Alternatively, you can write this more tersely as follows. I also mentioned you don't need to have these semicolons. I just do those because I'm used to seeing those in C. C++ was my first programming language. Might have not been the best start, though. It's notoriously difficult, and a lot of people just hate it. Anyway, we do that because these are equivalent. The reason being, this works out to that. Actually, if I'm going to say these, then I should have read the previous version. This is how you write comments, is these two dashes. Anyway. Where the previous version, these two programs, these two functions are equivalent. The reason being, this is translated. No, it doesn't even do that. That is a very roundabout method of explaining it. The way it works is effectively it just replaces all instances of penis with this. And if you remember what I mentioned about all operators just being functions, then that is equivalent to this, which is in turn equivalent to this. Well, actually, the way that works is it's technically that, but doesn't matter because addition is associative. Alright, and now I can demonstrate that my beautiful program here works correctly. So that's not a good standard to set. Our program is now compiled. and we can run it, and it'll tell us 70. This program isn't very good. Well, it's fairly useless, but it demonstrates these principles pretty well. However, this is a bit ugly. In Haskell, you generally want to avoid parentheses. That's just the way it is. So, here's this associativity operator. Basically, what this does is it says, evaluate the right-hand side of this operator first. So really, it's about functionally equivalent to having parentheses there, but you know, it's thought to be cleaner. And similarly, you can use function composition. As I've done here. Now, this is functionally equivalent to what I had before, but in some cases, using function composition can be a bit prettier, and it helps understand you can do that. So, for instance, the function dick. You can give it this argument, this definition. This is an IO monad. Just ignore that for now. Unless you really want to read that spec and understand what a monad is, I will be discussing that later. Probably in the next video, because monads are extremely important. Anyway, yeah, this is one of the reasons function composition is nice. One of the reasons I think that you can also do this. Nope. I was wrong again. Anyway, I've forgotten because I don't write stuff like that. Yeah. Also, here, when you use the so-called point-free style, you don't need to have the parentheses. This is valid. Just to demonstrate that, see, 70. It works just as intended. It's still a useless program. Get in a map, which I may have discussed, but I don't remember because I've tried to record this video 3 times, including this time, and my memory is not the most amazing thing in the world. I apologize if I've discussed this already. Actually, why am I doing that in a proper program? I can just use interpreter. In this case, this is the list of all integers between 1 and 5. what map does is it applies a function to all elements of a list independently of each other, and it returns the resulting list. So here we should see that these are equivalent. Obviously, that's not a great example. So, let's map 2 to the power of...
Oh my god, that's a big ass list.
Yeah, you see here, Haskell can support pretty large lists. It can also support some pretty nice list operations. Like map, which you should now understand. We also have zip width, which you give it a function, and you give it an argument alpha, an argument bravo. Here, this just equals should be able to see what this is doing. You know, it just applies this function to each pair from these two lists. So let's use the function take. Take 5 elements from zip width, this function here. See here, yep, that looks pretty accurate. This function approaches 1. You should now have a basic understanding of zip width. Let's get into more list operations, such as list compositions. Now this list isn't very useful. That'll just hang on me forever, but these two lists here are equivalent, because if you've ever worked with set comprehensions and set builder notation, then you know that you can say complex numbers alpha such that alpha plus 2 equals alpha plus 2 is greater than alpha plus 1, which, as you should know, is just complex numbers. Anyway, this has the same purpose. This has the same effect. So, we can operate on the elements of this list. We can square all the numbers in that list. We can take the square root of the square of all the numbers in that list. We can take the cube root of all the numbers in that list. and so on and so on, and you can do all these complex things, all these complex operations on that list. Personally, I prefer using map and filter. Oh yeah, that's something I haven't mentioned. Filter. Mention these little back ticks. You can use those on any function which takes two arguments to turn that into an infix function. Now that's fairly useful when you want to make stuff a bit more human readable and more similar to mathematical notation. Alright, filter. This will show all even numbers in a fairly stupid way, because I could just multiply all those by two. But, see here, we're getting all the even numbers. Because filter shows all elements of a list which meet the conditions, or for which, you know, it applies a function to all elements of the list, and it returns an element if that function is true. So, these are equivalent. You know, this will help you if you're familiar with set builder notation. If you're not, then hopefully you understood my explanation. Oh yeah, let's use some of that, some of what I taught you. Length is a function which returns the length of a list. Here I am writing what is called a lambda expression. This is just a function. It's a function without a name, and that's why they're also called anonymous functions. Should not have given it that variable name. Actually, you know what? I'll go into lambdas first. These two are equivalent. And these are equivalent. It's just an alternative way of writing functions. Alright. Oh, damn it. I lost what I was writing. Yeah, that's fine. This function here does is this generates the factors of the input number alpha. In a bit of a dumb way, then it checks to see if that list is equal to an empty list, which it will be if it doesn't have any factors. Output seems good. So now we can use filter again to generate some primes.
Ooh, fun.
We don't need to start at one because, by definition, one is not a prime. And yes, this is slow because the interpreter is slow. Haskell can actually do this pretty impressively quickly. If you make a compiled program, you know what? I'll show that. To enable buffering, or disable buffering, to get fast results. But you should be able to see here that this is faster. You know, this is generating you know, 10,000 primes every couple seconds. But we can improve the speed of that. Just directly printing each returned prime, and I've gone and called it to a prime. Oh. There's the problem. It just returns a monad with a map. Again, I'll explain monads later. Yeah. Now you should see the output immediately. You see here, that's quite a bit faster. It's not C fast, but you know, I'm not using a square root there because square roots do not work with integers in Haskell. They don't work up to infinity. They cut off at the limit of, I think it's double. But you can. Do this. And you see now, the speed is worlds better. Because it's, big O square root of N, as opposed to big O N minus 1. Well, we're already almost at 2 million. We are at 2 million now. Yeah. Just know that this interpreter is not fast. It is terribly slow. So, you know, if you want any kind of real speed, then do not say that Haskell, well, that bit about wanting real speed is irrelevant. Before you say that Haskell is slow and cry about it, compile a program and optimize it using this minus Oscar 2 flag, because Haskell is really blazingly fast if you know how to use it correctly. Yeah. If you want to learn any more about the syntax, then read this spec. And most importantly, play with Haskell. Make some programs. Use it. Just this bookwork crap is lame. So, you know, go out and make some programs and have fun with that.